I was going to share with you a number of issues about global organizing, and I am going to talk about something I call galactic organizing, and it's a way of rethinking the way we organize, because organizing itself, because of management schools and so on, has become certain kinds of things, and we all know the traditional map of how you develop hierarchies in a organization, about the boss and the assistant bosses and the assistant bosses and then the others, you know, and the world has become very, very different. And for in the last 30 years, when many of us have been global wanderers and challenging institutions all over the world, we learned something very different. We learned about three very important ingredients. One is, how do you get participation? How do you get participation? How do you get very, very clear actions as a result of the participation? And three, how do you do it in such a way which is very light? Because we do not have the kind of heavy resources. Brother Hussein was speaking about how, you know, you were fighting huge battles, and you had to fight them in totally different kinds of ways, sending up metallic balloons that totally confuse these high-tech planes in there. And what the stories we used to tell of how just two Native Americans who saw a big fort in America with large numbers of soldiers, you know, and they wanted to teach the fort a lesson. So what they did was that they went to the fort, they shot at the fort with flames on arrows, and very quickly one of them will go another direction, they will shoot another one, and then another one will go just around. And it appeared that actually the fort was surrounded by a few hundred Indians. It's just these two persons who had set their arrows nicely, just rushed around, lighting them up quickly, quickly go, like, and the fort was, you know, receiving this from all. And when they found this, they decided that, you know, they were actually surrounded. They decided to surrender, yeah? Which is an interesting story of how sometimes tactics can actually change the situation because of the perception also on the other side as to exactly the size of your power. I talk about the galactic organization, and I have a map that I want to show you of the galaxy. That's my lecture. The center of it is a symbol that many of you know. It's a symbol that very often is called yin and yang, yeah, in that. But not well known is the fact that actually it's a scientific symbol. And this symbol developed out of a calculation of the link between the sun and the earth and the shadow that is made by a pole. And you get that particular symbol. And this symbol became, you can say, the cosmic symbol. And it became very central to understanding what life was about, what the world was about, and was the link between the heavens and the earth. And this became so central because understanding the link between the heavens and the earth made you understand interconnectivity, made you understand exactly how things operate, and that if you played with one, you will be affecting the other. And from there, the concept of balance and harmony, of man, woman, and many other kinds of opposites were attributed to this particular symbol. But this cosmic power of the link between the heavens and the earth give you a way of thinking about connectivity, about creativity, about the fact that you're actually dealing with something that actually has you can say, no limits, has just boundless kinds of connections, and the power of imagination and creativity in this process, therefore, is very great. And then you have all kinds of circles and the power of the circles, of all shapes, and I have not drawn them there, but usually I draw them small, big, you know, overlapping, and it's just all kinds of circles that are operating. This power of the circle is the power of all that connectivity. And all kinds of groups have different kinds of connections, and there are groups that you connect to one person, you may connect with a million. For example, when we started a anti-corruption movement here, we said, okay, what do? We want to be big from the beginning. So we looked around for leaders who represented organizations that themselves had huge constituencies. So by bringing together 15 people to start the anti-corruption movement, but with each one of them representing thousands of people, maybe from the Lawyers Association, the Doctors Association, from the Trade Union Association, from the Teachers Association, from the Consumers Association, from the Academic Association. Once you bring them together, you actually, by bringing together 15 people, you may be bringing together 150,000 or 500,000. So the concept of circles that may look like a point, but actually bring you strength becomes very, very special. And the power of this is remarkable. And therefore, our strategic involvement of people and institutions becomes a way of growing instantly. Yeah? You can grow instantly by just one contact in there. So the idea of circles and connectivity and building is very important. The other very important element in the galaxy is a word that's been used by a number of people, and it's a word that combines chaos and order. It's a word called chaotic. It's oxymoron, but again, it's like the yin and yang. Your understanding of how things need to be organized, and that's represented by a Sufi principle. It may have come from Persia, yeah? Of that straight line with the curvy line. You're very clear about what your objective is, but the path to the objective may require a course that, you know, has to go there and sometimes even go back, yeah? Because going back may be, in fact, going forward, if you know when to do it in there, because then you can let somebody fall, but not on you and kill you in the process. You know, they fall on themselves and hurt themselves. You know, you move. And this is a very important principle in Korea, and they actually have a name for it. I have forgotten. And this is the art of wrestling. The art of wrestling is to actually use the power of the other person to be his weakness. Yeah? The power of the other person to be the weakness. Yeah? And so you learn of how the movement of the person will go to you, and you move out, and the person falls. Yeah? And that's you. So your tactics are all relating to using the power, and some of the things you were talking about this morning also show you how a different kind of imaginative thinking can be there, because bigness has its own pitfalls. We had, for example, at one time in our fight with Nestle, we had meetings in the United States where we got them to concede to a number of things on a Friday. Then we had a meeting with Nestle in Sweden. Now, we were able to communicate because we were passionate people who were in touch very much about an issue. And we would work in the weekends, and to us it was a 24-hour times 7 times 365 or whatever it is. I mean, it was a continuous. For the corporations, there was also office hours. Yeah? And so when the meetings finished in the United States, the Nestle people just made a report to the headquarters in Switzerland. And then, of course, by Monday, maybe that office would reply to alert. And maybe they were not even sufficiently alert that there were meetings going on. And our groups were meeting these groups independently all over the place, because we learned a tactic, a very, very important tactic of being very global and having a very big connected face, but at the same time with such autonomy that it became a problem for the industry, that if they wanted actually to destroy us, it was very difficult for them to destroy us. We'd have a different person, and then constantly they were finding that, my God, the headquarters is in a place called Penang. We can't even find it on the map. Yeah, we can't even find it because the world headquarters of the consumer movement was here in Penang. Yeah? And they couldn't, and they don't have, you know, persons who could operate in this place. And they just couldn't believe it. Can you take something serious, that there's a world movement that's been coordinated out of this little place? Don't be serious. You know, you can imagine the discussions in the office of Mobil, which had 50 persons at that time, totally monitoring all the major television stations on the world as to how the company was being presented. I mean, 50 people, the PR feedback. That time they didn't have search engines and Google, so you did your search in a totally different kind of way. And I had made a speech showing how Mobil was having a pesticide can with all kinds of restrictions and warnings in the United States, but selling pesticides in Hong Kong with no statement of even ingredients or warning at all, completely. And this is like one of the biggest corporations of the world that was operating, and we showed their hypocrisy and the way that they were operating. So this kind of chaotic operation in terms of organizing became very important. And that meant that actually membership of these organizations was institutional as well as individual. Okay? And that meant you also transcended sometimes what was a bureaucracy that meant you were inhibited unless the boss gave the okay. And you find in every organization there are different levels of enthusiasm. And then we did some research about this, about five different levels of enthusiasm. Yeah? And each type of enthusiasm is a different enthusiasm. One, there's an enthusiasm to leave the office to go home. I mean, that's also enthusiasm of a certain kind. Yeah? It's a negative. So you have various kinds. And how do you pick these enthusiasms? So you create a structure in which institutions can participate as well as individuals. And we decided to avoid the term member. We talked about participants. You were in if you participated, you were out if you didn't participate. And you had a small statement of a core value to which you signed on. And said, we agree that we support the International Code on Breastfeeding, and we agree that we will not receive any money from pharmaceutical informed companies. So a couple of very simple things. And you signed on to this, you became a member. So we made it simple, yet the governance structure, again, had to be organized in such a way that it was, the power was at the periphery. The power was the periphery, and different groups played different kinds of roles. And in the description of my presentation here, I talked about hubs. I talk about hubs. I talk about incubators. I talk about catalysts. I talk about multipliers, and I talk about accelerators. So these five kinds of, you can say, I mean, biodiversity, you know, different kinds of species which contribute to the garden of change, yeah, that you want. Each one of them has a certain meaning, and you will have to find them in different places. In the old traditional, we'll say, okay, we want to raise money, we have to do this and so on, but you look around, and one of the greatest principles that we learn of, again, instant growth, is to adopt the principle of hitchhiking. Hitchhiking. That is, you look around for organizations that already, in fact, are involved, already have the skills, who can, with a little bit of effort, also take on this kind of work globally. And we found many, many lines. If you want to do a newsletter, if there's some organization that already has got a fantastic newsletter, there's an outreach, you work together with them and add a supplement, and then they take on this role, and they develop their mailing list. They are very happy too, because they grow in the process. So many, many things were done in this kind of instant growth way.